Split the night and touch the sound of silence. Hey, you guys. So it's kind of late, and I know I didn't do this the last time, but I decided to take the easy way out rather than collecting images. So it's 10:03 p.m. I apologize if my thoughts are a little scattered. I'm kind of exhausted from work. But I just reread A Small Good Thing by Raymond Carver. And I have to say, reading it the first time, it really wasn't, I don't know what I expected, but I can tell you from the opening, I immediately, as somebody who works in retail, I immediately thought, oh, she probably has the I want to talk to a manager haircut, which I might include a picture of that at the end if I feel like it. But the one thing I noticed immediately about this story was the writing. It's very, in a way, it's very simple. And what I mean by that is the sentences are short, and it seems to be in the sort of the point of view that we were talking about in my creative writing class, third person limited. So, or maybe it's even to where, I forget what it's called, but it's the sort of writing style where you just sort of see things through like a camera view, right? To where you're seeing things as they happen. There's really not a lot of added emotion into it. And what I mean by the writing being simple, just the beginning. Saturday afternoon, she drove to the bakery in the shopping center. After looking through a loose leaf binder with photographs of cake taped onto the pages, she ordered chocolate, the child's favorite. The cake she chose was decorated with a spaceship and launching pad under a sprinkling of white stars, and a planet made of red frosting at the other end. His name, Scotty, would be in green letters beneath the planet. So, you can see what I mean by sort of simple, in a way, just stating the facts. There's no emotion, no, oh, Anne felt like this as she was going to driving to the supermarket. And, in a way, that's different than a lot of things that I've seen, and the way that he even just talks about Scotty, who, you know, it becomes sort of a plot device in a way, despite the fact that he's a child. He calls him the child. He doesn't really name him outright, the child Scotty, or Scotty, her child. And I found that really particular, so I'm kind of curious to see what you guys thought about that. But just a quick thing, my thoughts overall on the story is I really enjoyed it, and I felt like it was really about how people connect with each other in a way of tragedy, or try to connect with each other. A lot of the way the writing was, it was very clinical. And I think that the lack of emotion in a lot of the writing was supposed to be a point. Like, in the fact that maybe we don't connect with each other as much as we could have, or we don't connect with each other on the way that we assume that we do. Do you really, with strangers, when I'm talking to them, or when you're talking to them, if you have any customer service jobs, when you're talking to them, like the interaction between the baker and Anne, do you really care about what they say? Most of the time, I'll admit that I don't. I'm talking to my customer and I'm going, hi, how are you? My thought is, oh, great, you know, another person that I'm going to have to ring up. Or, hey, my day's going crappy, my day's going well. And my person, the things that are going on in my life are more important than what the customer says. I mean, as sad as that is. And I feel like that's the way it is for Anne and Howard. You know, what's going on between in their lives, Anne and Howard each lead separate lives. Anne's life is focused around Scotty, and Howard's life is focused on, you know, work and being a good husband and maybe a good father. It really doesn't mention his relationship with Scotty. Not that well, other than to say that he's had a pretty ideal life so far, you know. Until now, his life had gone smoothly into satisfaction, college, marriage, another year of college for the advanced degree in business, a junior partnership in an investment firm, fatherhood. He was happy and so far lucky, he knew that. His parents were still living, his brothers and sisters were established, his friends from college had gone out to their places in the world. So far, he'd kept away from any real harm from those forces he knew existed and that could cripple or bring down a man if the luck went bad, if things suddenly turned. So I thought that was really interesting. He's measuring his life and how well or how badly it's gone. in generalized life events. There's not, again, there's not a lot of emotion in it. And that's the thing that struck me the most out of all of this is the emotion. Because normally when I read something, I'm reading to feel like I'm in the characters' heads. And I don't really get that. It's like I'm reading. It's almost like I'm watching what's happening. I'm not seeing it. It's on a it's through a television screen. I'm seeing this drama as it unfolds in front of me while I'm reading this. And you see a little bit of emotion between the characters interacting, but it's not outright stated. Like I said, that's just the thing that struck me the most about this story. And the fact that it is about a tragedy, but the end, you know, commiserating with somebody, talking about how you feel, and the interaction at the end between Anne Howard and the baker, it leaves you thinking that maybe there is some, that you can move on from tragedy. And I really like this. "Smell this," the baker said, breaking open a dark loaf. "It's a heavy bread, but rich." They smelled it, then he had them taste it. It had the taste of molasses and coarse grains. They listened to him. They ate what they could. They swallowed the dark bread. It was like the daylight under the fluorescent rays of light. They talked on into the early morning, the high, pale cast of light through the windows, and they did not think of leaving. I don't know, the ending really struck me, especially that last line. You know, their child's just died, and I'm sure that they have all of these preparations to make, but they're not worried about that. They're finding a way to connect with another person, especially over their tragedy and the tragedy that his life's been, in regards to not really having much of a family, not having kids, which is what you measure success in, I suppose. And I think that's another thing that just struck me, is that they did not think of leaving. About how, take a second and like think about how much of our lives we live away from other people. Like, throughout my day, I'm not concerned about the people around me necessarily. I'm not concerned by my interactions with other people. I'm concerned, okay, I've got to move on to this task and this task and this task. And if you think about it, maybe Howard and Anne's lives would have been more fulfilling had they had that extra interaction with Scotty. Not just concerned with him as a status symbol or as a symbol of their status, but had those emotional connecting depth-filled interactions with him. So what did you guys think? I know I'm not articulating my thoughts very well, so I'm going to let James sum it up, because he usually gets what I'm trying to say without me being able to say it. All right, so that was A Small Good Thing.